So recall we started off with defining random variables xij, okay, which is basically indicator random variables, okay, takes either 0 or 1. So here xij is 1 if the element of rank I is compared with element of rank j. I think many of you have understood it yesterday, and there were also a couple of questions. So I'm going to demonstrate it with an example again. Okay. So yesterday I just messed up with ranks yesterday with the elements. So I'll just take a quick example today and demonstrate it. Okay. So hopefully that will make it clear. Okay. So let's take an 8-element array. Fill in elements arbitrarily. Okay, so let's write down the ranks of the elements quickly. So the smallest is 2, that's rank 1. Next is 3, rank 2. Next is 4, rank 3. Next is 7, rank 4. Next is 8, rank 5, rank 6, rank 7, and rank 8. Okay. So how many xij's are there? Xij, I less than j, less or equal to 1, 2, 8. So 8 choose 2 variables. 8 choose 2 is how much? 28, right? 28 variables in total. Okay. So let's just pretend one run of quicksort, okay, with some pivot of our choice, okay. So the first one I'm going to choose is, let's say, element 8, okay. It's the first pivot. Yeah, so our random coin tosses lead to 8, let's say. Okay, so element is of rank 5, okay. So recursion level 1, pivot has rank 5. Okay. So now let's see what are the variables that are being set. So 5 is being, element of rank 5 is being compared with all other elements. Okay. So the variables that are going to be set to 1 are x15, x25, element of rank 2, all other elements, x35, x45, x56, x57, x58, all of these are set to 1. Okay, at recursion level 1, all of these variables, how many variables are there? N minus 1, that is 7 variables are there. Okay, so let's just keep a counter, so 7 comparisons are made. Okay. Now recursion level 2, so what is L and R? So let's just write what is L and what is R. So L, R. Okay. So L is what? All elements that are less than 8. Okay. 7, 3, 2, and 4. R, all elements that are greater than 8, that is 9, 10, 18. Okay. Now again, let's choose pivot. Let's say pivot for L, so the recursion level 2, pivot for L is say 3 is the pivot. Okay. 3 is the pivot. Now at recursion level 2, so what are the variables being set?
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Sir, to get L and R, we have to do comparisons, right?
Yes, true.
So we didn't make the corresponding random variables to be 1.
No, we made, right? So these are the random variables which are 1.
Okay, just with comparing the fifth rank element.
Exactly. Yes. So this is the comparison made. Fifth rank element is compared with every other element. So x15, x25, x35, x45, x56, x57, x58 are one. Okay. So this is our nomenclature, right? We just take this pair as unordered pair so that I is less than j. So I'll always write it as I less than j. So 5 and 6 are compared, I'll just write 5, 6.
All these comparisons will give us the correct position of the number 8.
Sorry?
So all these comparisons, 1 with 5, 2 with 5, 3 with 5, this will give us the correct position of the number 8.
Yes, of course. Once you know L and R, you know the correct position of number 8, right?
Okay. Thanks.
Yes. So once you know the sets L and R, you know the position of M. I mean, since elements are all distinct, I mean, there is a unique position. So, okay. So at the second level, now for L, so the pivot chosen is suppose 3. Okay. So what is the rank of 3? Rank of 3 is 2. Okay. So now what are the comparisons made? Comparison with element 7, 2 and 4. Okay. So let's just list down the variables accordingly. So rank of 2 is 1. So rank x1, 2. And rank of 4 is 3. So x2, 3. Rank of 7 is 4. So that is x3, rank of 3 was 2, right? x2, 4. So all these variables are set to 1. And these are exactly the comparisons. Okay. Now left has one element, right has two elements. Okay. And this is for L. Recursion level 2 for R. So choose some pivot. So I'll just choose 10. Okay. So 10 is the pivot. So if pivot is 10, what are the comparison? So 9, 10, 10 and 18. So 9 is what rank? 6. So x6, 7. 7 because rank of 10 is 7. And then x6, 8. These are going to be set to 1. Okay. So far, yes.
I think it's 7.
So it's 7, 8.
Oh, sorry. Rank of 7 is, yes, you're right, right. Right. X7, 8. Thank you. X7, 8. So far, up to recursion level 2, these are the variables which are set to 1. Okay. Now, here, what is the left subarray at recursion level 3? So there are L1, R1, L2, R2, okay? So L1 will be just 2, right? Something less than 3. R1 will be 7, 4. R2 will be, L2 will be 9, this is 18, okay? So only for R1 comparison has to be made, right? Irrespective of what is it, so it will be the corresponding ranks. So it is 7 is of rank 4, 4 is of rank 3. So it will be x3, 4. So at this point, this will be x3, 4. It will be set to 1. Any other place, there is no comparison between the elements, right? So that's it. Okay. So now what are the total number of comparisons? Let's count it. So here there were 7, 7 plus 3, 10, 2, 1. So 13 comparisons in total. Okay. So 7, let me be precise here, 3, 2, 1. So total 13 comparisons, right? 13 total. So if you look at these variables xij, they pretty much capture comparisons, set of all comparisons. So like we discussed yesterday, if element of rank I and rank j are compared once, they will never be compared again. because the primary thing is one of them has to be pivot. If one of them has to be pivot, they can never occur in a subarray together later on in subsequent recursions, right? So these variables precisely capture comparisons. So, or in other words, once you have run quicksort, the number of comparisons made is exactly number of xij which are one, set to one. See, potentially how many xij's are there? So total potential max n choose two. But clearly quicksort, when it does divide and conquer, when it subdivides array, it eliminates lots of potential comparisons. It does not require many of them. In particular, when you take the pivot, right? So the left subarray and right subarray, across they will never be compared. So these elements will never be compared once you get L and R at the first level. Similarly at subsequent levels. So it already eliminates a lot of comparisons. But the way we have defined these variables, the number of variables which are set to one precisely captures the number of comparisons. Any question on this? Okay, so if there are no questions, we'll move ahead. Okay, so we'll just write down the expression. Okay, so this is the English description of what it is. So yeah, this is basically the statement that I made. Okay, so this is an indicator random variable. It is 0, 1, and if at all ith smallest element and jth smallest element will be compared at most once. See, the only confusing part here is we are talking about rank, element of rank I and rank j. This is for our convenience. Okay, so many will complain that, oh, how do I know the position and so on. If you look at the array, you know it, right? Algorithm need not know. Algorithm basically sorts, and at the end of the algorithm you know the positions, but we just keep a watch. So you can just imagine we are putting tags, so for each element we are putting the rank and see how they are compared. For algorithm, it does not need to know the ranks. It just compares. So basically comparison of two elements, the way we account for it is via rank. That is easier for us to handle. That's all. This is particularly for analysis purpose. I mean, many of you will be confused. Okay, how does the algorithm know that what are the ranks of elements it is being compared? So, yeah, at the end of the first iteration, right? You know what is the rank of the pivot, but for other elements you don't know, right? But the algorithm need not know. It's only for our analysis purpose. Okay, so this green thing is only for our knowledge. Algorithm knows only at the end, so algorithm will not know. But we are just accounting for the comparisons or keeping track of the comparisons through these variables. It's just for convenience. Okay, so I mean it's fairly easy to understand. Okay, so particularly when we want to compute the expected value of these variables, that is what is, so our notion comes very handy. Okay, good. So the total number of comparisons is basically sum of these variables. We have seen that the number of ones among xij's is exactly the number of comparisons, right? So hence total number of comparisons is captured by the summation. Okay, so this is what. So the quantity that we want, expected number of comparisons over the random choices of the algorithm, is nothing but the expected value of x. Okay, so the expected number of comparisons is nothing but the expected value of x. So now the basic probability theory stuff.
Sir,
yes, yes.
In that previous slide, why we have to explicitly say ith smallest and jth smallest element?
Yeah, so that's what. So we are talking about rank, right? So when I say jth smallest element, it's rank j. This is ith smallest is rank I.
Okay.
Yeah, the rank is, I mean, I just purposefully did this. I mean, so that people will know. See, rank is usually a confusing concept, right? What is rank here? So rank I is when I say element of rank I, means ith smallest element. Rank j is jth smallest element. That's all.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. Yes. Okay. So now we are going to use basic probability stuff. So expectation commutes with the summation. So that is linearity of expectation. Okay. So expectation of x is expectation of the sum, which is equal to sum of the expectations. Okay. So all it boils down is to compute the expected value of xij. Again, let's write the formula for expectation. Expectation is value into probability and sum over all possible values. So the only two possible values are 0 and 1 and 0. So 1 with the probability that x is equal, xij is equal to 1. 0 with probability that xij is equal to 0, which is nothing but probability that xij is equal to 1. Okay. So this is, in fact, if you have random variable which is 0, 1, the expected value is nothing but the probability that the variable is 1. Okay, so it's always the case. So all it boils down is to estimate this quantity. That is, so when I say probability, right, should always be clear about the random choices. What are the random choices? So this probability, expectation, everything over the choice of the pivots. But that's not once, right? So the messy thing about this is, it's a recursive algorithm. Okay, so pivot at the top level, and then for L and R, then again there is a pivot, then again L and R, then again L and R, and so on. It can go up to whatever level, right? Say L recursion levels. So the random choices, here there is a random choice, 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 and so on. So only thing is, these are all kind of independent. I said kind of independent because the subarray that you get here is dependent on this random choice. Okay. So if you go modulo that is, if you ignore that part, these are independent processes. So once you have the left subarray, the choice of pivot is uniformly at random. Once you have the right subarray, the choice of pivot is independent, uniformly at random. But however, the left subarray is dependent on the first choice. So they are not completely independent random processes. Okay. So they have dependency. The dependency in the form of the subarray that you inherit at this recursion level is dependent on the random choice that you make at the previous level. That's all. Okay. Yeah. So at the outset, this looks like a complicated variable to analyze. I mean, the sense that particularly because of this recursion, and at each recursion level, we are going to make samples, new samples. Okay. And the domain of which is dependent on the previous samples. Okay. So that looks a bit complicated, but we'll see that. So in fact, we don't have to be bothered about this process completely to estimate the probability. Estimate the probability that xij is equal to 1. Okay. So the claim is this: probability for any I less than j, I just missed the quantifications, for all I less than j within the range 1 to n, probability that xij is equal to 1 is this number, 2 by j minus I plus 1. Okay. So that looks fairly, I mean, at least the statement wise, it looks fairly simple, right? It basically depends on the length or the difference between j and I, or length of the interval. Okay. So we will see the proof. So proof requires demonstration. So I'll just demonstrate it with an abstract array. Okay. So what we'll do is, we will look at the array in sorted order. Okay, so this is element A1, this is element A2, so rank 1, etc. Okay, etc. up to AN. Now I look at AI here, I look at AJ here. Okay. Okay, so let's formally consider the event. So let's say Aij be the event, Xij is equal to 1. That is, Xij is compared. That is all. Okay. Now, when I say compared, you can ask question, okay, at what recursion level, doesn't it matter, and so on. See, for the end product, right, so all we need is number of Xij's, that is 1, right, or the expected expected number of Xij's, that is 1. It really does not matter at which recursion level they are compared. So we are not going to be bothered about that, okay. So yeah, so for that, at this moment, we are not going to require that information. So let's do the analysis in the following fashion, okay. So let's just look at one recursion level, okay. So here, element, the array has size n, so we'll just say the first recursion level. The analysis is similar irrespective of the recursion level, okay. So let's look at the choice of the pivot, okay. You are going to randomly choose a pivot, right. The pivot could be here, pivot could be here, pivot could be here, or pivot could be one of them, okay. So what is the interesting event for us? One of them have to be the pivot, right. See, INJ will be compared only if, or to be precise, INJ will be compared, when I say INJ, element of rank I and element of rank J. Okay, I hope I'm not confusing. So whenever I say IJ, it's about rank. Okay, so ith smallest element and the jth smallest element. So for element INJ to be compared, we know that only possibilities either I should be pivot or J should be pivot. And this can happen at any level of recursion. So for a recursion level at in consideration, if one of them is pivot, then it's a favorable event. Otherwise, it's not a favorable event. Okay. So let's just analyze case by cases, in fact, four cases, depending on whether the pivot is to the left of I or right of J, or pivot is equal to I or J, or pivot is in the middle. That is between I and J. Okay, so let me write down the cases. Case one, pivot is to the left of I. Case two, pivot is to the right of J. Case three, pivot equal to I or pivot is equal to J. Case four, pivot lies in the proper interval IJ. So it's not equal to I or equal to J, but it is contained within that. That is, it is greater than I and less than okay, that is I less than pivot less than G. Okay, so let's analyze it now. So what happens if pivot is to the left of I? Yeah,
they won't be compared at that level.
So at this level, INJ will not be compared. And
they'll be in the same subarray, so they can be compared in next recursion level.
Yeah, so they will be in the same subarray. So in this case, it will be in the right subarray, right? If the pivot is to the left of I, the elements of rank I and J will be in the right subarray. So in other words, the chance of them being getting compared has not changed, right? Yeah. So still there is a possibility that Xij is equal to 1 or the event Aij occurs. Do I make sense? Yeah.
Yes.
So in this case, I and j will not be compared at this level. At this level, but can be compared in future.
Sir, I have a question here.
Yes.
You see that probability of them being compared hasn't changed, but if I see at this level, the probability of one of them being picked is two over n, because we have n elements and we can pick either of them to be the pivot.
Yes.
And in the next level, assuming that k elements out of n elements have been put in the left subarray, the probability of them being picked in the next level will be 2 over n minus k. So the probability of them being picked in the next level has actually changed as compared to this level.
Yeah, so I'll come to that. That's a good point. Okay, that's a usual confusing point. Okay, so I'll come to that. So yeah, let's just continue with the case analysis before coming to the computation of probability. Okay, yeah. So what happens in case one? In fact, the same happens in case two too, right? So the same is true for case two. So both combined, it is similar. Okay. So in either of the cases, if you land up in an element which is to the left of I or to the right of j, that is rank larger than j or rank less than I and j are not going to be compared. That is, our event will not happen at this level, but at subsequent level they can happen. Okay, at subsequent level they can happen. So in other words, for us, these two events or these two cases are kind of irrelevant. What I mean, they don't affect anything. So if you choose a pivot to the left of I or to the right of I, it won't right of j, it won't affect us as such, right? The probability of our event happening or the possibility of our event happening does not get affected. Okay, so these events are kind of irrelevant for us. Now, if pivot is I or pivot is j, we surely know that Xij is equal to 1. Okay. And if pivot is, so it, yeah, any question on that? The first part, when I say irrelevant, I'll justify it formally very soon. But right now, I mean irrelevant in the sense that it does not affect the event that we are interested in. It seriously does not affect the probability of Xij being equal to 1. Or in other words, I mean, to be precise, as long as Xij is not equal to 0, there is always a possibility of Xij is equal to 1. Okay. So in other words, this region is completely irrelevant for us. It does not affect our variable at all. Okay, when I consider Xij, I mean, it might affect for some other pair, but we are particularly interested in ij now. Okay, in the third case, clearly Xij is going to be 1, because if one of them is pivot, they both are going to be compared. Okay, and in the fourth case, if pivot happens to be in between, if this is where my pivot is, what can I say?
Xij equals to 0.
No comparison. Some of you said it already in the last lecture itself, right? So there will not be comparison between Xi and Xj, or I and j, sorry. Yeah. So in other words, in this case, Xij is surely going to be 0. Okay. So there are only two cases where Xij is going to be affected. So now how do we estimate the probability? So the only problem here is in estimating the probability, we have lots of recursion levels. Okay, so let's just look at it. So at level one, I'll just level one. Okay, so case one and two, one or two. Okay, so that means depending on if it is one or two, I'll just write it as L. Okay, let's assume without loss of generalities one for our understanding. Okay, so this is say case two. You'll take R and so on. But what is it remaining for us? We have an array which contains element of rank I as well as element of rank j. Okay, so only at place, so say at say some ith level of recursion, maybe I is 10 or 20, whatever. Okay, so pivot is in the range I to j. Yeah, so in this case xij is equal to 1 if pivot is one of them, it is zero otherwise. Okay. So now our probability of setting the pivot to one, does it really change how many levels of recursion you have come through? So one of you said, right, at the first level, it will be 2 by n. Because the probability of choosing I and j among 1 to n. I claim that that is incorrect statement. That is because for us, our sample space, our sample space for this event, what I mean is the relevant sample space for this event is just this window. It's not any of these elements. Because the probability of our event happening or the chance of our event happening is unperturbed by the choice that you make. If your choice is to the left of I or to the right of J, it does not affect. It really does not matter. Why does it matter? Because in the future, there is a chance again. The same kind of experiment again happens in the subsequent recursion, right? At this recursion, in case case one or case two happens, that means, that does not mean that xij is zero. It just means that there is one more chance or one more shot. That means these events are completely irrelevant. You can just imagine that. These are all completely irrelevant events for xij equal, being equal to 1 or 0. Because they don't affect anything. So those choices mean nothing.
Sir, so in other words, can we think like this? Huh? The probability of xij being 1 does not depend on the size of the array, but depends on the choice of pivot. Because as you said in the previous point.
Yeah, choice of pivots and ij.
Okay, yes, ij. If you fix an ij, I'm saying.
Exactly. If you fix an ij, it only depends on the choice of pivot in this range. I mean, in the sense that you can pretend that you're choosing a pivot from this range. Only then that is what is going to be the probability for you. Because anything else is not going to affect. It doesn't matter how many levels of recursion and so on. So at any point of time, your probability is going to be the probability of choosing ij subject to the condition that you are choosing an element in this range. Because that is only going to affect xij. Nothing else is going to affect xij. So all these choices, they don't affect us at all. It doesn't matter what you choose. So in other, the right way to see is the sample space for us is going to be this, okay? Only problem is, see, if you choose, I mean, not problem, I mean, the way to explain it is, if you choose an element to the left of I or to the left of J, that means you haven't chosen anything from the sample space. Or in other words, with respect to the variable being a random variable xij, these levels are not random experiments at all, because you are not sampling from its sample space. Do I make sense? Yeah, is this explanation, does it make it clear? So you can just imagine all other recursion levels where you are choosing, the pivot happens to be to the left of I or to the right of j, they are not random experiments pertaining to xij equal to 1 at all or 0 at all. They are completely irrelevant. Or in other words, the only random experiment that matters is when you choose an element within the range I to j. And within that, what is the probability that your element will be I or j? That is all that matters. Okay. Yeah, any questions? So the point made by one of you, right? So why is it not 2 by n at the first level? It is not 2 by n at the first level because the remaining n minus I minus j minus 1 elements, right? If you choose them, this is not like a random experiment at all for the event that we are interested in. It really does not matter. Of course, it is crucial that at the subsequent iteration, we are going to conduct this random experiment again. If it is not, if you are just making the experiment in one shot, right? That is, if you are just making the experiment at one level, there is no recursion call at all, then I will agree that the probability is 2 by n, not 2 by j minus I plus 1. Because we have subsequent experiments, right? Our chance of getting I or j compared is not affected at all. If you choose an element which is beyond this range, that is very crucial. So the statement, I can't see the names, one of you made, right? At the first iteration, it should be 2 by n, is correct if there are no subsequent iterations. Okay. Yeah. Okay, so with some painful notations, I mean, this can also be proven mathematically. You can just consider events that are relevant and events that are not relevant, and then split this into conditional probabilities. Okay, so eventually you'll get the same probability.
Sir, just a clarification. So the random experiment here is choosing a pivot.
Yes.
Okay. And choosing the pivot, if it doesn't happen from the sample space, it is not a random experiment.
Yeah, for our argument. Event. Exactly. I mean, in fact, xij is undefined in that case, right? See, if it is just one random experiment, that is one level of choosing pivot. If you choose pivot beyond this range, that is less than I or greater than j, we can't say if xij is 0 or 1, right?
Yes. So it's not a valid trial.
Experiment didn't affect the value of outcome at all. That means it's not a random experiment for. Okay. So then what is the probability? So the probability is hitting upon I and j, given that your element is within I and j. So that's exactly this number. So within I and j, there are exactly j minus I plus 1 many elements. And out of which, two are favorable elements for us. So this is the probability. By the way, one thing. So I think in the last two or three lectures, I forgot to mention the reference. Okay, I have promised that I'll give reference. So right now, I'm following only Blum's notes. Okay, so this is the, I think, fourth notes in the series. So I've been following completely Blum's notes, at least for next lecture. Until the next lecture, we'll be following Blum's notes. But I just want to warn you, I mean, in the sense that please follow the lectures. I mean, just don't rely on Blum's notes, because we do much more detail in the lecture than that is in the notes. Okay, so usually many of the things will be just one sentence where we would have spent some 5 to 10 minutes on it. Okay, so please use the slides as well as the lectures. Go through the lectures. There will be recordings of this, and also I have also made a short recording which is like 40 minutes. This video will be like 50 minutes, including the class discussions. So if this is also manageable size, I mean, we'll just as well stop pre-recording and I'll have only live lectures. Okay, so far there has been no problem. Okay, any questions on this?
Just one.
So is that clear?
We have fixed the sample
space.
Just
write down this. Yeah.
Since we have fixed the sample space, we have defined the probability to be 2 by j minus i plus 1.
Yes. Not defined, I mean, that is the conclusion. It's not defined, I mean, that the sample space happens to be that. Otherwise, our variable is not defined at all. Okay. So that is how, that's the way to
view it. Based on the case 3 and case 4, can you explain how we get to this without, like, I have an intuition that it is this, but based on case 3 and case 4, how did we get to this?
Yeah, so see, case 3 and case 4 establishes that our sample space is going to be this, right? So
yes.
Now, all iterations where the sample space does not even contain this, right? See, even if your experiment was randomly choosing, but the outcome was not within this sample space, that means they don't affect you at all. So
yes.
It's like this, okay? So I have a subset in my mind, okay? Now, yeah, let me do it here, okay? So let's say I have a subset 1 to n in my mind, okay? So now what I do is I conduct experiment, okay? So I don't do anything if the element X is not in S. I just sample again. Okay. So let's do it in more precisely. Let's suppose S is like this. Okay. So this is to the something less than S and this is greater than S. So what I do is I keep on sampling. If elements are less than S or greater than S, it really does not matter to me. I just throw away. Okay. And if the element is within S, okay, so I have some particular element A in S. So I say that success if the sampled element is equal to A, failure if X is in S, but X is not equal to A. Now, what is the probability of your success? The probability of success will be equal to A by cardinality of S. This is only if you are repeating the experiment until you are able to decide whether there is a success or not. If X is not in S, I don't even take it into account because it's neither success nor failure. There is no outcome, right? See, if you had defined, if X is not in S, then it is a failure. Then the probability of the event is A by the whole sample space, which is n. So the comment that one of you made, right? At the first iteration, it should be 2 by n. 2 by n is right if at the first iteration itself, if the pivot is not equal to I or pivot is not equal to j, you are going to say that xij is equal to 0. Then yes, then that's the right probability. But we are not doing it. We are not saying xij is equal to 0 either, right? So it's as well, so for that moment, there's no random experiment for us at all. Yeah, so random experiment happens only if your sampling happens from within the domain. So in this case, random experiment happens only if your sampling is within this set S. Otherwise, it's irrelevant. So this works only if you're repeating. So the recursion calls are helpful in that way.
Yeah, so hello?
Yes.
Yeah, in this example only, you said if you pick an X, you sample an element X, and if that X is in S and is equal to A, it's a success.
Yes.
Then it is one of the element in S.
Yes.
It should be 1 by S or A by S.
Oh, A, 1 by S. Sorry, you're right. Yes, sorry. I'm sorry. Yeah, thank you. It should be 1 by S. Yes. Not A. A is a value, right?
Okay, thanks. So you're saying if X is not in S, then it's an irrelevant event. This is the example that is modeling that problem. Okay, thanks.
Exactly. Yeah. Okay. Can I have, what is the time? 49. I'll take 2-3 minutes, okay? Okay, so let's just conclude the proof. So expected value of X is sum of expected values of Xij, which from the claim, we concluded that it is 2 by j minus I plus 1. Okay, now this summation, I'll just expand the summation. So summation, I'll just write it as I equal to 1 to n minus 1, j equal to, is it n minus 1 or n? Okay, I can also take n, but in that case, it becomes 0. So j equal to I plus 1 to n, 2 by j minus I plus 1. Okay, just rewrite this. So I equal to 1 to n minus 1, I just expand this summation. So this is 2 into this number. I think there is only half, okay? So one is not there. So this is nothing but harmonic series, right? Harmonic series up to n minus I, okay? So this is upper bounded by 2 times the summation. Each summand is upper bounded by the nth harmonic number. I'm not saying n minus I plus 1. I just say nth harmonic number because harmonic number grows, right? So yeah, where harmonic number, for those who have, so Hn is summation 1 plus 1 by 2 plus 1 by 3 plus etc. plus 1 by n. This is the nth harmonic number, okay? So I'm not proving it, but you must have seen, I think must have proven by induction, right? When you, yeah, most of us did in high school. So when we learned about induction proofs, we usually do this harmonic number, I mean harmonic series. So this is upper bounded by log n, okay? So the overall thing is upper bounded by 2 log n, log to the base of e, okay? So that is all. So we get the same bound, in fact. Only thing is here, the analysis is, we don't use any integration or we don't even need guess and verify. There's no recurrence here at all. Yeah, only problem is understanding, estimating this probability or this expectation. That's a bit counterintuitive. It takes some time to understand. Apart from that, this is a completely different proof. And one interesting thing is you know exactly what are the elements being compared. So you're basically exactly accounting for the comparison in an explicit fashion. Whereas in the previous one, we just dump everything into the recursion. Okay. Here, because there is no recursion, this gives you explicit expression in terms of number of comparisons. Okay, so that way, it's a different proof. It gives you slightly better insight into the algorithm. And it also demonstrates the use of expectation, linearity of expectation, and so on. Okay. Yeah, I think we can have a couple of questions.
Sir, this is Srinivas, sir.
Yes, Srinivas.
Sir, after this session, I will just directly call out name. Can I directly call out names and take the attendance, sir?
Yeah, fine. Then we'll have to end the session a bit early. Okay. You'll need 5-10 minutes, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, sure.
No, at least like, yeah, there is, sir. I'll just take
Read out the names. They will have lectures, right? They will have lecture
okay.
At 10 o'clock. So we cannot go beyond. I mean, it's already, I have already taken 3 minutes.
Yes, sir.
For the next part. Okay, so.
Okay, sir, then. Okay, sir.
Yeah.
Hello?
Yes.
Yes, sir. One suggestion. For computer vision class, TA is using some Google Chrome add-on, which gets the list of students.
Yeah, that is what we have been using, but there is some problem with that add-on. It misses out some students, okay?
It doesn't capture all, like some 3 or 4 students, it just misses.
Yeah, okay. So that is why, I mean, he wants to do verification once in a while. I don't think he'll do it every day, but yeah, once in a
while.
Just a clarification. Is it like, can we say it's analogous to like we have two bags and we are drawing from two bags? So actually our experiment is to draw from one bag, and if we are taking elements less than I or less than J, we are drawing from another bag. It only defers our event to be happened, but it does not change the probability.
Yes, yes. So yeah, so when you keep on doing it until your event happens, right, it is equivalent. So you're just repeating this until you hit the right bag. So if you are hitting the wrong bag, they're all ignored because they are not relevant events at all. So they don't contribute to the probability at all. Yeah, you're right.
It only defers the event, but it does not.
Exactly. It only defers the event. Yes. Yeah. Good. Good. That's a good explanation.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
You said that the sample space should be greater than I and less than J. Like between I and J.
Greater than or equal to
or less than equal to I and J. So
yes,
if we select any random pivot between the interval and mm-hmm. after sorting or after comparing, the I and jth element will come to either left side or right side of the chosen pivot, then the experiment will be irrelevant, right? Because we don't know whether I or J will be compared or not.
No, so you mean the pivot is chosen between I and J, right?
Yes.
Is that right?
Yes.
That means they will never be compared, right? We know that they will never be compared. Xij is going to be zero. Because they will be in the left as well as right subarray. For sure, we know that they will never be compared. That is how the algorithm is, right?
Okay, so I was thinking like if we select the random pivot and then we compare, and after mm-hmm. comparison, the ith and jth. Okay, so the pivot is one of the ith or jth, right?
If they are, so if pivot is one of I and J, then we know that I and J will be compared for sure.
Yes.
Okay, if the pivot is in between, that is greater than I and less than J.
Yeah.
Then for sure we know that they will not be compared.
Okay, I understand.
Okay, I think it's already 56. We will stop the session now. We'll see you tomorrow. Okay. So in case if there are offline questions, please shoot it over email. Okay. So yeah. Or else if you come bit early, I'll be there from 7:50. I'm 10 minutes or 51:52. If you come early, you can also ask questions there. Okay. So I'll